Lord, we thank you again for this yet another preaching opportunity. We thank you, Lord, that on this first Sunday in September, that we show up, Lord, with a heart of thanksgiving. Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us. Thank you, Lord, for all that you will do. Allow us, Lord, to continue to try to be obedient and do what you ask us to do. Knowing, Lord, if you get the glory, that's all that matters. I ask now, Lord, that you send your power down in this preaching moment, that all of us will leave this place just a little bit better than we came in. It's in the name of Jesus the Christ we pray. Amen. To the book of Psalms. Psalm 116. Psalm 116, verses 12 through 14. Psalm 116, verses 12, 13, and 14. What shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vow to the Lord in the presence of all his people. What shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. I want to use for a subject, a charge to keep I have. A charge to keep I have. Like many of us, my parents tried to expose me to things and the situations that I didn't appreciate or understand because of my youth and my immaturity. And one of the things that I was exposed to that I didn't appreciate then that I'm grateful for now is that I was raised in a time where there were some great gospel artists and some great gospel music. And being the son of a pastor and being raised in the Baptist convention on the local and the national level, I was exposed to gospel music that I didn't appreciate when I was a child. Because growing up in the 70s and the 80s, it wasn't strange to come to church and they hit a choir singing some Albertina Walker before the preacher got up to preach. And I remember that one year at the state convention that the first lady of gospel, Shirley Caesar, was up front singing Hold My Mule. Going to the National Baptist Convention, I didn't appreciate being in the presence of the Mississippi Mass Choir when they sang Be Ye Steadfast, or the Georgia Mass Choir when they sang Yes to Your Will. And I've seen all of these artists and I've heard them sing their best songs. And I didn't appreciate it then because of my immaturity and my youth. I couldn't understand what they were talking about because I didn't understand what Luther Barnes meant when he sang, I'm still holding on. It didn't really settle in my soul when James Cleveland sang, Where's Your Faith in God? I really didn't get it when they sang, If Anybody Asks You, Where Am I Going? Where I'm going soon. I'm going up yonder to be with my Lord. I hadn't been through enough yet to understand that through it all, that I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God, and I've learned to depend on his word. And as a child, I didn't understand what Andre Crouch meant when he asked the question, how can I say thanks for the things you've done for me? Things so undeserved, yet you gave to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, I owe it all to thee. Then he said, to God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory for the things that he has done. With his blood he has saved me. With his power he has raised me. To God be the glory for the things that he has done. And when we look at Psalms 116, we see that the psalmist does what Andre Couch does, because they stopped and they thought about everything that the Lord had done for them. And I want to propose this same question to us this morning, because when was the last time that you sat yourself down and allowed your mind to think about all the things that God has done for you? And not just the things from last week, not just the things on your last prayer, but have you ever felt the happiness? Have you ever felt the pain? And have you ever found yourself back down memory lane? And when you go back down memory lane, I want you to look at all the ways that God has made, all the doors that God has opened, all the mountains that God has moved, all the enemies that God has handled, and all the sickness God has healed. And is there anybody here with a good memory this morning of everything that God has done for you? Because every now and then you ought to sit yourself down and think about everything that God has done for you. And when you go back down memory lane, you're going to find some meaning and some appreciation in Psalms 116. Because when the psalmist sat down and went down memory lane, this is what the psalmist says in verses 1 through 11. I love the Lord, and let me tell you why. Because when I look back over my life, the Lord has done some things for me that only God can do. And I'm in verse 1, and I love the Lord because the Lord has heard my voice and my supplications. And the reason that I love God so much is because when I couldn't handle it by myself, when it was more than I could put up with, when life got the best of me, I went to the Lord and he heard my voice and my cry for mercy. And I wish I had some witnesses this morning who knows that when you call on the name of God, that the Lord heard your voice and came to see about you. Is there anybody here this morning who can testify that he is a prayer answering God? Now watch verse 1, because he has heard my voice and my supplications. And just in case the car next to you doesn't know nothing about that, let me tell you that I want that ought to make you happy. Because there have been some times that what you prayed for was wrong, but the Lord still answered your prayers right. And has anybody other than me ever prayed to God for some stuff and some things that you know that you didn't need? But the Lord is so good that he took a wrong prayer, but he gave you a right answer. Now, if that didn't get you, not only have I prayed for the wrong things, but there have been some times when I didn't even know what to pray. And I'm looking for some honest people right up in here whose life has been so jacked up. Life has been so confusing. Life has been so messed up that you didn't know where you were coming or going. And all you could do is lay in your bed and say, help me, Lord, because I really don't know what I need, but help me, Jesus. I really don't know what I'm calling you to do, but help me, God. And y'all, we serve a God that when all we can say is help, that he's able to do what needs to be done. Now, I see y'all back there on the back row in the balcony, and y'all are acting too righteous for me this morning. So I'm coming to get y'all in a minute, because I love God, because he gave me the right answers when I pray the wrong prayers. I love God because he answers my prayers when I don't know what to pray. But here's the shout for the people on the back row, because the Lord has answered some prayers that you didn't even pray. And I wish that I could tell you that I always pray. But y'all, there's been some times in my life when I didn't call on the Lord. I didn't run to the Lord. I didn't seek the Lord out. But the Lord showed up anyhow. And is there anybody watching on Facebook this morning who knows that he answers some prayers that you didn't even pray? Now watch the text. Because I love God because he gave me the right answers when I prayed the wrong prayers. I love God because he answered my prayers when I didn't know what to pray for. I love God because he answered the prayers that you didn't even pray. But watch verse 2. Because I love God because he inclined his ear to me. Because the truth and the fact about prayer, because whenever our prayers stop, that's where the Lord is just getting started. So whatever we ask him for is only the start of what he wants to give us. That's why Paul tells us, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. Because we serve a God who deals with us with a big heart. A God who goes above and beyond what we pray for. Because he answers to go higher than what we ask. So I love God because he gives me the right answers even when I pray the wrong prayers. I love God because he's answered my prayers when I know what to pray for. I love God because the Lord answers the prayers that you didn't even pray. But then watch verse 6, because the Lord protects the simple. And y'all, that word simple is a synonym and a replacement for stupid. So y'all, the Lord protected me when I was stuck on stupid, when I was doing dumb stuff and doing wrong stuff and doing disobedient stuff. And the Lord was still protecting me. And when other people deserted me, God still protected me. When other people ignored me, God still protected me. When other people disregarded me, God still protected me. And I know that y'all didn't pull up the hitter this morning, and somebody's going to get mad. So I'm not talking about the car that's beside you, but I'm talking about the car that you in. Because the person in the car that you in has been a handful to deal with. Because the person in the car that you in, they haven't always been righteous. You haven't always been obedient. You haven't always been in worship. And I know that you look mighty holy this morning, that you got your mask on, you got your latex gloves on the side, got hand sanitizer in your purse. But let me tell you your truth, because your neighbor has been a handful, but the Lord is still protecting them. And I wish there was somebody here this morning who can declare that God has protected me. God has been merciful to me, because I know that I know that I know what I've done wrong. And God is still protecting me. So I love God because he took a wrong prayer and gave me a right answer. I love God because he answers my prayers when I don't know what to pray for. I love God because the Lord has answered prayers that I didn't even pray. I love God because the Lord protects me when I'm stupid. And watch what else the psalmist says. And I'm in verses 3 and 4. Because I love God. Because when the snares of death encompassed me, the pangs of Sheol laid hold of me, I suffered distress and anguish. Then I called on the name of the Lord. Oh Lord, I pray, save my life. And y'all, that word Sheol is hell. So the Lord brought me out of hell. Now let me tell y'all what that's hard for some of us to understand. Because we think that hell is just a place that somebody else is going to when they die. But when somebody out here should know this morning about some living hell, and that in the middle of some living hell, that God still brought you out of it. Does anybody know what it's like to walk past hell, but to have God bring you out? But here's the shout, y'all. Because I've been through hell, but you don't even know it. And you got no idea what I've been through, because the Lord brought me out. Because if you knew the hell all I've been through, I wouldn't be standing behind this podium. If you knew the places that I've been, you'd never want to hear me preach. But y'all, the Lord is so merciful, and God is so good, and the Lord is so gracious, that you can't even look at me this morning and see the hell that I've been through. So watch the text, because since God has answered my prayers, and since God has gone above what I asked him, and since God has protected me when I'm stupid, the psalmist asked the question in verse 12, what should I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? And you really are a sad somebody if the Lord can do all of that stuff for you, and not one time do you ask the Lord, is there anything that I can do for you? Because how can I thank God for everything that he's done for me? Because the psalmist says that when I think about what I can render and offer God, that I will lift up the cup of salvation. And the cup of salvation is the Lord's free offering for your life to be new. So the psalmist says, when I think about what I need to give God, the first thing I'm going to give God is to accept this offer. So I want to give the Lord something. But the first thing I can give him is to accept the offer that he has. So when we think about how good God has been to us, he wants us to give him our hearts. He wants us to put our lives in his hands. He wants us to surrender our souls to his will. He wants us to obey his commandments for our lives. And all he really wants for us is us. So the way that we say thank you is by giving our lives to Jesus Christ, by opening up our hearts to God, and by allowing the Lord to reign in our lives. Now here's why it gets quiet right up in here. Because in modern day Christianity, we fail to appreciate and think too little of our salvation and our redemption. And we act like being saved is just something else to add to our resume. And that being a Christian is just something else to do. But that's why Hebrews chapter 2, verse 3 asks us, how can we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? Because salvation is a gift of God that he has given us through the death of his son. And how dare we pull up every Sunday and not receive his grace? How dare we watch on Facebook Live and listen on the radio and not give the Lord our hearts? How dare we take the blessings and not give anything back to God? And the psalmist teaches us that not only will I receive salvation, but I will lift up my salvation. So if you say it and your coworkers don't know it, if you redeemed and your neighbors don't know it, if they know your favorite team, but they don't know your God, if they know where you went to school, but don't know where the Lord found you, if they know where you're from, but don't know where you're going. Verse 13 commands us to go public with our faith. Now, before COVID-19 hit, one of my friends hit me up because they were looking for a new job. And they wanted to know if they could use me for a reference. And they said, I'm applying for about 15 jobs. And I'm going to send some people to you. And I need to make sure that you're going to say some nice things about me. And I told them that you know I got your back. And I'm offended that you would think that you had to ask me to be a reference. And they said, well, I had to learn the hard way that you don't just put anybody down as a reference. Because you have to make sure they're going to say some good things about you when somebody calls or emails them. So you can't put everybody down as a reference. Because everybody ain't going to tell the truth about what they know about you. So I wanted to be sure that I could put you on my list. And I told them that, yeah, you can put me on my list. But the Lord has a question for us this morning. Because can the Lord put you on his reference list? Can God send somebody your way who needs to know that he's able? Because somebody needs to know that he can make a way. Somebody needs to know that he can open doors. And can the Lord trust you to lift up your cup and to let somebody know what he's able to do? So I will lift up my cup of salvation and I will call on the name of the Lord. So the way that we thank God for what he's done is by calling on his name. Now y'all don't miss this, because he heard me in verse 1. He inclined his ear to me in verse 2. He protected and saved me in verse 6. He delivered me in verse 8. So the way that I thank God for hearing me and protecting me and saving me and delivering me in the past is to call on him again. Somebody missed that. So the Lord has answered my prayers. And the way that I thank him is by calling on him again. So y'all, if the Lord did it yesterday, the only way to thank him is by calling on him today about what we need him to do tomorrow. Now, most of y'all know that we are in between the conception stage and the design stage of our church campus. And when we decided what architect and engineer we were going to use, we had to choose between two of them, because getting more than one bid is the best way to get good business. Because getting more than one bid means that you're not getting overcharged for your prices. Getting more than one bid means that the range of the work is going to be the same. Getting more than one bid, make sure that you get a contract to do the work. So we're not going to build this church without getting more than one bid. So I'm at home in April, and I'm looking at the two bids that have come in, because we needed to make a decision on the architect to get this thing moving. So I'm looking at the bids, and my son walks up on me, and he asked me what I was doing. And I took this as an opportunity to teach him, and I told him I was looking at these bids, because whenever you hire somebody to do some work for you, that you need to get more than one estimate so you won't get overcharged. And that the range of the work is going to be the same. Because that's just good business to get more than one bid. So a few days after that, we had a problem in the bathroom. And the toilet wouldn't stop running. So I'm trying to call our regular plumber so he can tell me how to get the toilet from stop running. And my son heard me on the phone. And he says, well, who else are you going to call? Because we have to get more than one bid to get this toilet to stop running. And I said, no, we don't, because that's only for Progressive. And I told him, we don't need more than one bid at the house, because we have Julio. And he said, who is Julio? And I said, Julio is our regular plumber that always fixes what we need him to fix. And since he's done all the plumbing in the past, we don't have to put a bid out for everybody else. Because when you have somebody who's done the job already, somebody who's made a way already, somebody who's taken care of you already, you don't have to put a bid out for nobody else. So y'all, I thank God by making sure that he's the only one that I call. So the Lord has done too much for me that I'm going to take his offer and let everybody know about it. The Lord has done so much for me that he's the only one that I call on. And then watch verse 14. Because the Lord has done so much for me that I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Now what you all want to know is what is the vow that the psalmist is making? Because a vow is a promise. So the psalmist has made a promise to pay his vow in the presence of God's people. Now you would think that the psalmist would say that since I love God and since God has answered my prayers, that I will pay my vows to the Lord just in the presence of the Lord. Now here's the promise that the psalmist made. And I'm in verse 17. Because he says, Lord, since you've been so good to me, that I will offer to you a thanksgiving sacrifice. So I made a promise to the Lord that every time God brings me through, that I would be the first one to tell him thank you. So when the Lord makes a way, it's not going to take a minister of music. It's not going to take a preacher to make me get out of my car and give God the glory. Because when I think about what God has done for me, nobody makes me have to makes me praise him. But I praise him all by myself. And I came by to ask y'all a question this morning. Because if you won't praise God in the presence of his people, when are you going to praise him? If you can't get happy sitting in the AC in your car, when are you going to get happy? If you can't praise him sitting at home in your house coat, when are you going to praise him? If you don't have an amen in his presence, when will you have one? Because nobody is going to protest and march if you shout on Sunday. Can't nobody pull you over by giving God the glory in your car. Can't nobody tell you to be quiet in your house. Because the psalmist reminds us that if I can pray for it, that I ought to be able to praise him for it. So if I can open up my mouth on a Sunday morning and ask God to do what I need him to do in my life, then I ought to be able to open up my mouth on a Sunday morning and thank God for what he's already done. So excuse me, progressive, because a charge to keep I have, a God to glorify, a never dying soul to save, and fitted for the sky. So thank you for the ways you made. Thank you for the doors you open. Thank you for the sickness you heal. Thank you for making a way out of no way. And I will bless the Lord at all times. My soul will make her boast in the Lord. The humble will hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. And y'all, if you got anything to thank him for, you ought to bless him right now. You ought to praise him right now. You ought to worship him even now. God bless y'all.